plug here too, because they would have wanted me to. My parents actually met at Oregon State University in the mid-60s, and so I may be, I don't know if I'm the first presenter in this room who owes her very existence to this university. I would not be here without OSU in so many ways. So I am, as Nicole says, I'm a legal historian, a medieval historian, a gender historian, and what Ed Spade, basically whatever else I can possibly be. In short, I'm interested in a lot of things, and for those of you who are in the historian's craft, what this means is I combine a lot of different methodologies in my work. So what you're going to be seeing today is sort of the fruits of me mashing together the approaches of a legal historian and gender historian, and working with several different types of sources and trying to figure out how to best read them to understand medieval women's experience in terms of legal sources. I want to start off with a little anecdote here, which I've called Constanza's Oath. And this all takes place, pretty much everything I'm talking about here takes place in 13th and 14th century Spain. So towards the end of the middle to the end of the Middle Ages, if that makes any sense there. So we start off in Barcelona in 1323, just after the death of a man named Francesc de Ferion. And Francesc, when he dies, his widow, Constanza, appears before the local royal judicial official in Barcelona to have her status as guardian of her minor children confirmed. Now the early part, and we have a little document of the oaths that she takes and the whole process that gets her confirmed as the guardian of her minor children and the administrator of their estate. Basically, she becomes the head of the household for them at that point. The early part of the document, this guardianship document, might apply to a guardian of either male or female sex. First of all, the official checks her husband, her late husband's testament, and indeed confirms that he has named her as guardian and administrator. This would not have been a given by any stretch of the imagination. Constanza, in her turn, formally accepts the position. And in her oath, she swears to exercise the duties of that office. She swears to always put the interests of her children before her own and to defend them against anything that could undermine their position. Furthermore, she gets a backup guardian, a male friend of her husband's, Francesc Grunyi. And the two together affirm that they separately and jointly are going to protect the property destined for their children. So far, so good. All of this would have happened whether she was male or female. But in addition, she's got to swear a couple of other things because she is a woman. First of all, she has, because she's going to be a head of household, she has to renounce a specific legal protection that applies to all married women that protects them from their husband's creditors. So if she's going to take on the responsibilities of being head of household, she has to take on the debts of that household, her late husband's debts. She's no longer protected from them. She renounces her protection. Second, she has to swear that she will not remarry, or she loses this whole office. She loses guardianship of her children. She loses the administration of the estate. So in Constanza's story here, in Constanza's oath, we see the meeting of two conflicting approaches towards medieval women. One of them assumes that women can be heads of household, that they're competent to do so, that they can be responsible to guard their children and to administer the finances and eventually these children's inheritance. The other half of this, the oaths she has to swear though, assume a certain gendered vulnerability. Constanza is required to have a male co-guardian, and she has to renounce her protections that were hers just because she was a woman. And she has to swear to not to remarry. The assumption here is that if she remarries, her new husband is going to be the administrator, the new head of household. In other words, she might be a head of household on her own, But once she's married, the assumption is that she won't be, that her new husband will be. Constanza's oath and the legal contradictions embedded in it raise a few questions that I'd like to address today. On the way to connecting up with our second presentation on law and gender a bit later in the Iberian world, in colonial Latin America. And they deal with several different types of sources. First of all, we want to find out where medieval gender ideas come from. And this is the jus communis and gender. And if that term jus communis is unfamiliar to you, by the time we finish this, it will be. Second, gender legal theory and Iberian law. How do those ideas make their way into Spanish, at this point, the laws of Castile and the crown of Aragon in the Middle Ages? Now, these are both dealing with what we as historians call prescriptive sources. It's a type of primary source that we call it that because it prescribes behavior. It tells you what you should be doing. But what about what people were actually doing? Here we move into descriptive sources. Law and practice, the multiple legal identities of Iberian women, in which I ask myself, how, if at all, did these ideas, did theory, manifest in practice? Is the relationship between women and law necessarily adversarial? In other words, are they always fighting against each other? And then finally, in conclusions, a larger methodological question. How might the answer to all these questions together help you provide an analytical framework for analyzing the relationship between law and gender in historical society? How do we read these sources to really understand them? All right? So, first of all, I want to start off with law and gender in the jus communis. The jus communis, it's a Latin term, it means common law, but that's not to be confused with the English common law. It is the common law because it forms what one legal historian calls a grammar of medieval law. The jus communis, and let me unpack this for a moment and you'll see what I mean. The jus communis is the law that underpins all medieval law on the continent, all of it. It's the framework that the actual law codes are built on. And it comes from two sources. The first of these is canon law, that's law of the medieval church. The second is Roman law, and it's much older Roman law. It's law from the 2nd through 6th centuries. So these two things get mushed together into this package of legal ideals and principles that get studied by, they get picked up again in the 11th, but mostly the 12th, 13th, and 14th centuries by students who go to law schools Italy, in the south of France, all over the place. And they study that. They don't study the law codes of their own countries. What they do is they study these general principles of law. Then they take them back to their own countries, and they're instrumental in crafting these legal codes, the laws of Spain, the laws of France, the laws of the various Italian cities. And when they craft these codes, as we'll see, they base them on the ideas of the jus communis. So the jus communis itself is not a law that's ever put into practice. It's a set of these older principles that underpin the actual active legal codes there. Why? Why would people study this old, especially the 2nd, 3rd, 6th century Roman law? Why would they reach that far back? Well, what happens is, around the 12th or 13th century, kings, queens, princes throughout medieval Europe get very interested in centralizing their authority. And they want law, they want to legitimize the idea that it's the king who rules all the dukes and counts and such, and the king's law is the law of the land. Well, where better to reach for that centralized idea than to the law of the Roman Empire, where every law is built on the assumption that there is one ruler who rules over everything. Just have one law to rule them all, kind of Lord of the Rings flashback. We were talking earlier about how I'm also deep in here. So, what does this have to do with gender? Well, the monarchs may have been sending their best and brightest, and you know, everybody off to go study this kind of law and bring it back and say, you know, help me construct a law code that's going to make me a powerful monarch. But what happens is when they bring these principles back, lots of ideas about lots of other things besides monarchy kind of hitch along with the ride. And one of those things is a conceptual vocabulary of gender. All right? So I want to talk a little bit about gender in Roman law and gender in the canon law before we move on to gender in the Iberian law. So you can see what these Iberian law codes are actually based on. Got a bunch of Latin here. I promise you, I'm going to work through all of this for you. There are a few terms that we see pop up a lot in these jus communis sources, especially the Roman law sources. The first of these, fragilitas. Fragilitas looks like fragility, and that's an easy way to remember it. It basically means weakness. It could be physical, moral, intellectual weakness, and more broadly, vulnerability. The idea here is that women are, now keep in mind, the idea of gender as a social construct is, they assume all gender ideas are natural. If you are a woman, you are naturally this way. If you are a male, you are naturally this way. So if you are a woman, you are naturally weak and vulnerable as compared to men. If you are a woman, you are also, you have this term levitas. If you are a woman, you are also naturally light-minded. All right, flighty. And if you want to think about how that contrasts, you guys have probably heard the term gravitas at some point. That sort of weightiness, that kind of, you know, sort of, it literally means weightiness, that is necessary, that is fundamental to the public life of Roman men. That's seriousness. And so women are the opposite of that. Women are naturally more flighty, and therefore unsuited to public life. Finally, you put these things together, and you've got this other term, imbecilitas. It doesn't mean imbecility necessarily. It means incapacity. Because women are naturally weak and vulnerable, because they are naturally light-minded, you put those things together, and these poor women are actually incapable of doing many of the things that men are capable of because of their nature. I'm just boring that way. One final term that isn't a part of this package but also pops up a lot is vericundia. Vericundia means shame or modesty. Women are naturally, according to Roman legal theorists, they're naturally modest. They naturally do not want to be out in public life so much. And so what they're going to do is they're not going to be, it's not appropriate for them to be in politics. It's not appropriate for them to be in the law courts. All right? They're going to be, anything that they need to do that has to do with the public sphere should be represented by men. Because that's doing them a favor, right? Because they're naturally unsuited to it because of their matronly modesty. Okay. We also have a lot of these same ideas show up in the canon law portion of the jus communis. Here's a few quotes from classical canon law of the Middle Ages. Gratian, a huge big deal here, says that man is the head of woman, woman the body of man. He's discussing the marriage relationship here. Johannes Teutonicus, a commentator on the decrees, the decretum, says that woman is created from man and therefore should be subordinate to him. Rolandus, another commentator, says that women's inferiority is manifestly proven. And then we have this, so this has to do with that kind of fragilitas and imbecilitas, that incapacity, that gendered inferiority. This one here, we see that idea of vericundia, matronly modesty. Pope Boniface VIII, on women in the law courts, he writes that it is fitting for women neither to wander about nor to mix with the crowd of men. All right? Keep in mind, when these men wrote these things, they assumed that what they were doing was writing about a natural gendered state, and they assumed furthermore that these things that we might see as oppressive to women, they would have assumed that they were, in a sense, protecting women and honoring the way that, you know, women and men naturally were, the sort of immutable gendered state. So that's that perspective from the past. So this is sort of the background of the background here. And that's where we end up. That's the foundation. If you were going to go to law school in the Middle Ages, this is what you would have studied. You wouldn't have studied Spanish law if you were from Spain, or French law if you were from France. You would have been studying this Roman and canon law. And you would have been studying it so you could get a job in some royal bureaucracy or church bureaucracy and make your career. But when you came back to your country and were helping be a legislator or write law codes or be a judge, you would have had all these assumptions about women to build into your local law codes. So that is where we come to this next section here of legal theory and Iberian law. Alright, so 13th century. The 1200s are sort of a century where every centralized state, if you want to call it that, medieval Europe, whether it was a kingdom or a county or a duchy, got very, very interested, especially kings and monarchs, got very interested in having their own centralized, legal system. And so the 13th century becomes this great age of legal codes, some of them for kingdoms, some just for cities. And I want to take a look at some of them in the Iberian Peninsula in particular. And I'm going to be looking at two, one because it's an area of my specialty, and the other, that would be the Crown of Aragon, right here. This kind of pink area. The other, Castile, because it's the area that most directly feeds into colonial Latin America. And they're sort of the two major principalities in the Middle Ages here. I'm going to start off with the Crown of Aragon, and just to give you a couple of examples. And hopefully what you'll see here is how these ideas I've been talking about for the jus commune about gender pop up in these 13th century legal compilations. One of them, the Customs of Tortosa, is a code from just one city, but it had a lot of influence. And Tortosa is right about there, back here. The Customs of Tortosa echoed Roman ideals of female modesty in its provision that women should not be compelled to appear personally in court. Again, that sort of idea of verecundia there. Turning to another issue here, the fueros or fueros of Valencia, that's like the sort of the local laws of the Kingdom of Valencia, which is sort of this area down here that's part of the Crown of Aragon, say that a wife's property should be immune from her husband's debts. Now you remember in the beginning when we were talking about Constanza's oath, one of the things she had to do is give up this entire protection, right? But most of these law codes took something directly out of Roman law that said, no, wife should not be held responsible for debts her husband signs onto. But the force of Valencia state most baldly the gender reason for it, where they say specifically, because the fragility of her sex, and they use that term, that Rome term fragilitas, the fragility of her sex should not be turned against her or result in the diminution of her goods. In other words, this poor woman needs to be protected. Her husband's creditors shouldn't be able to come after her because she has no idea what's going on. She's intellectually, you know, weak and vulnerable, all right? So we see those Roman ideas popping up very clearly in these various codes, and I could give you lots more examples from different places. But I want to turn to Castile. And so Castile here is this other, that could have been a disaster, this other kingdom right here. And specifically, I want to look at probably the most influential and important Iberian law code of the Middle Ages. When I say influential, I mean it was influencing law in 17th or 18th century Texas and California. And that's the Siete Partidas. The Siete Partidas of Castile. The Siete Partidas were commissioned in the 1250s by King Alfonso X, Alfonso the Learned, and they mean literally, the term means the seven parts. And so it's a code in seven parts. We just call it the Partidas sometimes. The seven-part code. Alfonso devotes the entire fourth part, so one-seventh of this code, to marriage and betrothal, mostly for property reasons, property and inheritance reasons there. In it, he has several assumptions that would have been that a Roman legislator would have been very comfortable with. First of all, inherent inequality. Likewise, the man is of a superior condition to the woman, as in many things and in many ways, as is clearly shown in the laws and the titles of this our book, which treats all of the matters aforesaid. I included that last part and underlined it because I just wanted to emphasize that, although I'm giving you one tiny little snippet, he is definitely saying, oh, this goes all through the code. If you've been reading and paying attention, this is no surprise to you by now. All right? I'm already on the fourth part. Married women, this is another interesting thing about women's gendered subordination. Married women are assumed into the status of their husband's families here. And I've left off the first part of this quote, so I want to read the whole thing. What he says here in the fourth part, he says, so even if a woman is of low birth and should marry a king, she shall be called a queen. Of course, the same works the opposite way. If a free woman marries a slave woman, or a slave man, they weren't that progressive. A free woman marries a slave man, their children are slaves. All right. So the woman and her children follow the condition of the father. So it seems that the woman's identity is subsumed into that of her husband. But she's the property she brings into a marriage is protected. It remains hers. Where a husband, and this is very interesting, the husband is the administrator. So a woman brings all this property, the dowry, into a marriage. And the husband, because he's the head of household, gets to manage it, right? That's that inherent superiority. Women are fragile. Women don't want to be in the law courts because of their modesty. So husband's much more suited to this in terms of their gender ideas. But he has to do a good job with it. She still owns it. And she can sue him back for control of this if he's incompetent. Where a husband is an imposter or a spendthrift of his property, so that his wife thinks that he will become poor through his own fault, and his wife fears that he will waste or squander her dowry, she can bring suit in court to compel him to surrender it to her. All right, so, you know, I get married to Francesc, and Francesc and I are in love, but Francesc very, very quickly starts blowing through all of his money on fast women and slow horses, and I'm afraid that he's going to start eyeballing my dowry. What do? I take my own husband to court, not to divorce him, but to sue for control of my own dowry. Compare this, because, and ironically, the reason I'm able to do this is because I'm so defenseless as a woman. Think about that. Back to this one. The fragility of my sex should not be turned against me. Therefore, I have a case in court against my husband to become a very strong figure in the management of my own financial resources. Okay. So, what we see here in both of these is this interplay of strength and weakness, of agency and vulnerability, running through all of these prescriptive sources. Even the Romans recognized, while we were writing all this stuff about women's vulnerability, that there were tons and tons of women out there who were managing their own property, and they had to make allowances for them here. So, how do we actually read the relationship between law and gender here? At this point, it's time to turn a little bit to away from the theory and towards the practice. Now, I want to make a little historiographic note before we do this. The study of medieval women has been around for quite some time, but it's been especially active since the 1970s. It's changed a lot, though, in the past, oh goodness gracious, nearly half century. Oh, I'm getting old. Okay. At first, historians of medieval women looked at these laws and they said, women are victims of sort of an oppressive patriarchal structure, right? Women, you know, men ran everything, and they ran everything in a way that was meant to keep things in control, in their own hands, right? Starting in the late 70s, early 80s, we start to see kind of a sea change in the way that historians read these sources about medieval women. And this is something that, you know, historiography, the questions may remain similar, but we start framing our questions in slightly different ways. And they would say, no. The historians began looking at them and saying, no, women were not victims. If we turn from just the prescriptive sources, the laws, to the descriptive sources, we see women exercising something we call agency. That is, working to determine their own fates, opposing these gendered restrictions on themselves. And so that became sort of a big, two different ways of looking at women's experience, not just in medieval society, but historically in general. One of the problems I have with both of these approaches, which is not to say that they're not valuable, they are, but one of the problems that I have with it is that whether you say women are victims or agents, what you're saying is the relationship between women and law has to be oppositional. In other words, women are either being oppressed by the law or they're fighting back against it. But women and the law are on opposite sides of the battle, no matter what. It's just a matter of, are they losing or are they winning? So, my book and some of my earlier work, before I got distracted by things like food and famine, one of the things that I suggested was a different approach. And to look at, rather than look at this as a fight, to look at this as an ongoing conversation, about women's status that legislators participated in, that judges participated in, and these are all men, mind you, but that women themselves also participated in, that their neighbors participated in. And it goes beyond just agency, because women aren't necessarily, as we'll see in the cases that I'm going to talk about, women aren't necessarily fighting against these ideas. They're using those ideas, as we saw in the property case, and as you'll see a little more, they're using those ideas about vulnerability and these other concepts in order to carve out advantages for themselves that actually may seem a little bit contradictory. So I want to go into this, and I want to go into this in terms of some multiple legal identities for women. And I want to talk about how women did this in three different registers. The first one I'm going to talk about is going to be their identity as women. All of them. The second, I'm going to give you like a little case or two from each one. The second one is going to be their marital or relational status. Are they unmarried woman, married woman, widow, other? How they had to negotiate that status in addition to just being women. And then the third is reputable versus disreputable. Are they good women or bad women? And so they've got to kind of find their place in all three of them at once as they construct their legal identity. And they have to do this all, they can't just say, oh, well, yeah, the law doesn't know anything about me, so it doesn't need to say, you know, I'm going to argue that I'm not vulnerable. No, what you'll see them doing is using that legal vocabulary as they negotiate, they do this very complex dance in the cases. And I find it just kind of fascinating here. So let me turn first to the one we've already talked a great deal about. And so I'll kind of keep it a little bit short here. That is the category of woman. And this is the legal identity in which women are all assumed to participate in these shared characteristics of vulnerability, of modesty, of incapacity, of fragility. And I'm going to give you like one, you know, Constance's own kind of talks a little bit about this. Another case from the 14th century. I don't have all the names up here, so I'm just using this as an illustration. You'll have to bear with me. A woman named Ermesenda, Ermesenda de Cabrenes. Ermesenda is a member of the minor nobility in the region around the city of Girona in Spain. And she gets called to appear before the local royal court to answer charges against her, probably for some outstanding debts that she hasn't been paying to the local cloth merchants. In response, she doesn't show up in the court. She sends her lawyer. And I've seen this, his response, and his response is 6 pages of citation to Roman and canon law saying why she shouldn't have to show up for court. But mostly what he says is Ermesenda, his client, is in fact a mater familias. She is a respectable matron, and therefore it's utterly inappropriate that the royal representative should call her into the city to mix with the crowds of men, lifting that directly from the older sources. And then if he wants a statement from her, he should send one of his representatives to her. All right? So we see her using these ideas of the category of woman and respectable woman in order to kind of dodge a little bit and to try and delay a bit about without getting called into court here. The second type of category here is, oh wait, sorry, I forgot. I put some extra bullet points. Anyway, we talked about all that. Let me remember what I've actually got up here. The second is relational status. Not only do you have to present yourself according to all these ideas about women in general, you have to present yourself in accordance with ideas that are appropriate to your state as married woman, as widow, as unmarried woman, and how well you negotiate these things and how well you use that vocabulary that is particular to your own station in the world in terms of your marital status or your relational status, daughter, wife, widow, etc., will help determine the outcome of your case. And I'll give you a couple examples. First of all, if you are a married woman, there are lots and lots of legal ideas out there in the Roman and canon law and in its the actual law codes that talk about this thing called marital affection. And marital affection is basically the respect that is due to you from your spouse. Women can use this, married women can use this in order to win cases against their husbands who are neglectful or abusive. A case from Valencia, a woman named Geralda, has a husband named Jaume, who she accuses of having beaten her, tormented her, injured her, and kept keeping mistresses, public mistresses as well. But when she brings her case, one of the first things she needs to do before she lodges these charges is to say, I married him and he was a good husband. And he treated me with the marital affection that was due to me. So she's establishing their position as a legitimate couple. She's establishing her claim to respectful treatment before she launches into the way that he has violated these standards. Likewise, relational status, we see it come up a lot in rape narratives of very young women. It shows up by its silence in the absence of rape narratives of married women, but we can get into that later. In the narratives of these attacks against young women, the parents who brought the cases referred to their victims as puellae, or young girls, emphasizing their youth. It's usually applied to a girl younger than 12. If the girl is especially young, they will often actually mention her age. Sad to say, I have not one but two cases from 14th century Catalonia that mention girls ages 9, which is not fun to read. And they also use terms especially like deflowered and corrupted. All right, so they're accessing that narrative of innocence and youth that has to do with young women in particular, in order to not just win their case, but to really kind of bring home the fundamental nature of the damage done in the act. Finally, there is the question of reputation. Respectable versus disreputable women. You not only have to establish yourself as being part of this pattern of woman and then making sure you put yourself in the right slot here, you have to make sure that the courts know that you are a respectable woman here. If you are a disreputable woman, you can be in big trouble and have fewer rights, actually. Take this case on prostitutes and property. In 1330, the king of Aragon issues a mandate to the city council of Barcelona. And here's what he says. He's talking about a complaint that certain respectable women in good neighborhoods have lodged against some of their neighbors. Sorry, I need a glass of water before I get into this, so I can be nice and ponderous. The king says, in that there exist certain infamous women in the aforesaid city who exercise the libidinous passions of their bodies. The good people who live in that neighborhood where said women live have attempted to expel them from the neighborhood, lest they cast a shadow on the chastity and pure reputation of others. However, this produced no effect in that the said women, the bad women, asserted that they own their own homes, from which they argue they cannot be expelled or ejected. So they're claiming their property rights. We bought these homes, you can't throw us out of them, we don't care what you think of us. Where was I? So, because these aforesaid women should not mix with good women, nor have any dealings with them, we therefore state and expressly order that if some of these women are brought before you, counselors, and it is established that they are indeed base and public women, so prostitutes, which is legal, by the way, in the Middle Ages, base and public women, or that such circumstances exist that they ought not be allowed to live in the company of good women, you expel them from their neighborhoods, notwithstanding the fact that they have their own homes in those neighborhoods, because it is permitted for them to rent them out. Okay, so you're not violating their property rights, you're just saying they can't live in their own home. They can continue to own them. So this is actually, you know, it's a good illustration of the fact here. And then we have, of course, the child custody cases. Now, we had one at the beginning with Constanza, but since we're talking about child custody, I just want to mention one more here. And this is in the 1320s. When Herr Barbaros died in the 1320s, Agnes, like many widows that we hear about here, steps in to assume full responsibility for the household he left behind. She becomes the sole guardian of her daughters, the administrators of her late husband's estate. It sounds like Constanza, right? She probably went through the same oaths. However, her sister-in-law, the sister of her late husband, takes her to court and says, no, 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 she can't maintain guardianship. Why? Because after her husband died, she started having an affair, a sexual affair, with another man in the neighborhood. And so because she's no longer a respectable woman, she can't exercise this position as guardian. It's not fitting. One of the most important things we can observe in this case law is that women are actively making use, and by the way, this is a woman accusing a woman, too, right? So she's making use of this legal vocabulary of respectability to accuse her former sister-in-law. Women are actively making use of this legal vocabulary that defines them as inferior, sometimes, in order to win their cases. So if we really were to insist on framing this as an agents or victims question, the answer would be yes. Okay. All right. So I know I'm probably getting very close to my time if I haven't run over, so I want to just hit some really quick conclusions here. And those conclusions take us back to Constanza's oath. How does she engage with these multiple identities? Well, first of all, she establishes herself as a respectable woman, unlike Agnes. Second of all, she establishes her relational status. She is permanently a widow. If she goes back into being a married woman, then she's not allowed to exercise her position as head of household. Where we see a contradiction is the category of woman. It gets tricky. Her new status as head of household contravenes assumptions about female vulnerability and incapacity. So what she has to do is specifically renounce her her protections against her husband's creditors, these protections designed for women's vulnerability. We should also note that this is a formal act for women, suggesting that where a man might take this sort of responsibility for granted, for a woman it had to be a ceremony and a ritual, and one that's kind of hemmed about by these conditions here. These gender ideas, contradictions and all, get carried, both the gender ideas and the prescriptive sources, and this is the printing of the Siete Partidas that ends up being the main version in the 16th century Mexico, I believe. These gender ideas are part of the complicated legacy left to modern women, and when the ideas in the prescriptive sources cross the Atlantic via the Siete Partidas, when Castile starts coming over, I guess Spain now, one can also imagine that we're going to see exactly or a very similarly complicated legacy in the case law. Those same ideas are going to be a part of women's experience in their litigation, but so too is going to be their ability to play with these ideas, not necessarily opposing them, although sometimes opposing them, but sometimes also using those ideas to their own advantage in litigation.